Hey folks, welcome to another Triple T Thursday. For those just joining us, that's tools, tips, and talk, where we'll discuss info for the knife maker. I'm freshly back from Maker Camp. If you've never heard of that, definitely go check that out. That's at the Blackthorn Resort in the Catskills in New York. That's upstate New York. Especially if you live anywhere near that area, definitely check that out. That's a really fun event. Got a new hat, got a bunch of new shirts, a bunch of new things, met a whole ton of people, and got to do some fun stuff. So go take a look. Today's episode, we're going to talk about Twist Damascus. That's going to be our Damascus pattern of the week. This is a pretty common pattern, but we're going to go into the more complicated version of Turkish Twist, where you layer Twist Damascus on top of itself. So we're going to go into that one in detail. So stay tuned. Let's go down to the table and take a look. So let's talk about Twist Damascus. The first thing we're going to talk about is layer count. The great thing about Twist Damascus, you can do it with a low layer count. This is one of the best patterns to do if you're just doing Damascus by hand. You don't really need a press or a power hammer to do Twist Damascus. This is the one that I did in the intermediate series playlist. So if you want to see how I did this by hand, go check that out. I'll put a link in the corner. So I'm going to do this with 25 layers. So you'll see what I'm going to put together for this Turkish twist. So let's talk about billet construction. Most people will just alternate their layers, just opposing layers of whatever your dark steel is, 1080, 1095, 1084, and 15 and 20, just get an alternating layer. What we're actually going to do is we're going to go for brighter stars in the center, and you'll see what I mean there. So what we're going to do is actually put a thicker layer of 15 and 20 in the center, and then, this doesn't really work here, but let's make these just a little more defined. We're going to put a thicker layer of 15 and 20 basically in the center and then out here. So we're going to do a triple layer here of 15 and 20 and a triple layer out here. Again, it's hard to see in this little construction. But what that's going to do is when we grind into this, you're going to see the stars, and I'll get to that later, a bit later on, because one of the important things about Twist Damascus is the pattern changes as you grind into the billet. The next thing we're going to talk about is just drawing it out. So after it's forge welded, we're going to draw this bar out into a square bar, and depending on what you're making is going to determine what you're going to draw it out to. If you were just making one twisted billet, you would probably draw it out to at least 3/4, if not an inch across, an inch by an inch, because you need to then flatten that and make that wide enough for a billet. Again, I'll put the metric down in the corner, because you're going to have to flatten that and be able to draw it out into something usable for a knife. What we're going to be doing is actually going to be taking a bunch of those narrower billets. We're going to do them in 5/8 of an inch, and then we're going to stack a bunch of those up and make a billet that way. And what we're going to do is twist them in opposing directions. So if you think of these as the twists, one's going to go this way, the next will go this way, and it will be kind of like this. Yeah, that's the way our billet is going to be. So let's talk about the actual twisting. I'm going to be showing this with a twisting machine. I've done videos on this. When we get to that, I'll give you a link to making one of these twisters if you want to make one. But this is easily done by manually twisting it. Here's a video of my buddy Jared manually twisting a billet. So it can be easily done. One really important thing to note, and a lot of people don't understand this, but if you take a billet, say a piece of Twist Damascus, or a rod that's been twisted, okay, and you flip it 180, it's still twisted in the same direction. Okay? Think of a piece of all thread or a bolt. It doesn't matter if you hold the bolt this way or you hold the bolt this way, the nut's going to go on the same way. Okay, so that's an important consideration. Don't think that you can twist one bar, cut it up, and then just flip them. That's not how it works. You physically have to twist them in a different direction in order to have opposing twists.
I got my billet all set up, waiting to get in the forge. Let's get it in there, get it forge welded, and we'll talk to you guys as we go. Remember, our sponsor is Maritime Knife Supply. I got the chance to hang out with Lawrence Lake from Maritime Knife Supply all weekend at Maker Camp. Great guy. Definitely check out Maritime Knife Supply for all your needs, whether it's steel, forges, kilns, you name it, they have it.
After a little dip in the kerosene to aid in the forge weld, we got this billet ready to go in the forge. Since I'm starting with 25 layers, this billet is almost 3 inches tall. One downside to the twist pattern is you'll lose a lot of material. We're going to be grinding a lot off after we do the twist, so it's important to start with a large stack. Now that we got it forge welded, we're going to start working on the sides and get this drawn out. One great thing about the twist pattern, you don't have to do a restack. We got enough in this. Once we twist it, we're going to have a great pattern. Another great thing about twist Damascus is you don't really have to worry about distortion that much. Once you twist it, it's really going to align those layers. I've had a lot of people ask about combining twists with other patterns, like doing a ladder pattern and then twisting it. The problem is that twist just kind of aligns those layers. You really don't see anything after you twist it. If you do, it's really subtle. This bar is starting to get kind of long. If I just kept going, a 5/8 bar would be about 4 feet long. So I end up cutting it into two for more manageable bars. Now you're going to see me alternate between the bars. Now I'm just trying to reduce each bar to 5/8, and you'll see me using kiss blocks to get them down to that thickness. It's important to use kiss blocks here because for me, the collet that I have for my twisting machine, I'm using a 5/8 collet, so it has to be exactly that thickness in order to fit in. So I'm just going to show you one of those bars getting drawn out. It just gets a little monotonous seeing both of them. One thing I always recommend when you're doing a twist is to round out the bar, because when it's twisted, if the corners are very sharp, you'll get these very sharp points on the twist. That's much more important when it's a 1 inch or a 3/4 inch bar. With this 5/8 inch bar, it's not as bad, so I'm not going to bother rounding them out. Now it's time to do the actual twist. I can only heat up about half of this bar, so that's the part that's going to get twisted. You want to make sure it's nice and hot. Here I slide it into the collet, lock the tailstock, and hit the foot pedal and give it a twist. Here's a link up in the corner if you want to build this twisting machine. For the Turkish twist pattern, you really want a lot of twists. The bar should really look like a piece of all thread when you're done. And remember, it doesn't matter which orientation you put the bar in. Here I'm putting it in backwards, but it's still twisting in the same direction. And here you get to see Jared's phone take a video of what I'm doing. I didn't have to use it on this twist, but I have some compressed air ready, and I use that to blow off a part of the twist to cool it down so it twists less. This lets you control how tight your twists are in certain areas of the bar. That's why it's good to have a foot pedal, so you have your hands free to do stuff like that. Here I'm starting to twist the second bar, but you know what? I forgot to change the direction on the drill. It's a good thing I only heated up half the bar. Now I've switched the direction on the drill, And you can see in the center where the two spirals start to combine. So you can tell that it's twisting in the opposite direction now. I cut that bar in half just so I could work with each one separately and get the twist perfect. Now I'm taking each of those bars to the press and squaring them off. This will make it easier to grind them into squares so we can restack them. The ideal pattern for a Turkish twist is nice even twists. Here, this is a picture from Michael Questenberry. This I consider the gold standard for Turkish twist. There's a link to his Instagram down in the description.
Okay, so we got the bars all twisted. The only issue I had was when I twisted the second bar, because again, these were cut in half, I forgot to switch the direction. So luckily, I only twisted half of it because only heated up half of it. And then I remembered, so one of these bars I'm not going to use, so we're just going to have a three bar twist. So here you can see they alternate, so we'll do a three bar Turkish twist. Next step, going to grind all these down so we get rid of all the little ripples, and then weld them together, and then back in the forge.
Remember I mentioned earlier, the more you grind into a twist pattern, the more it changes. Here's a great graphic that demonstrates that. We're going to be going for about the one in the middle, about five down. You see how the stars are in the center? That's what we're going to be going for. I've tack welded these bars together. Let's get them in the forge and get them welded up. We're just doing our usual forge welding here to get these all nice and combined. Remember, you need these really hot. What happens when you're forge welding is that the crystals in the steel expand and they grow over those lines. And that's what really the forge weld is. Now I'm working to reduce this billet down to about 0.03 of an inch. Remember, that's going to compress those twisted layers. We still need to grind some off, but first we got to forge this more into a knife shape. Here I'm just doing a quick run through the rolling mill just to make sure it's a constant thickness all the way through. Now it's time to start the hand forging. The first thing I'm doing is putting a bit of a curve into the blade. Then I'll start putting the tip in. The Turkish twist pattern just looks a little odd if you cut into the billet, so it's much better if those layers just kind of compress as they get to the tip. It just looks much, much cleaner. Here my little rebar handle falls off the billet. I end up dropping the billet a few times in this clip, but I finally moved to offset tongs and that keeps it in place.
Here we are after forging. I may do another forging round on it, but for now I just want to take the scale off it just to show you guys what it looks like. And we're really close, like there just may be some pieces here that I might want to forge a little bit, and then I'm going to end up just taking the tang. It was a little more steel than I actually needed for this, but let's take the scale off and see what it looks like.
I would normally do this with an angle grinder before I get to the 2x72, but this was late at night last night.
Here's the billet after grinding off. I definitely still have some forging to do on this. I'm going to have to bring this to a full point on forging because I just want that pattern. So this blade is going to have to definitely be forged to shape because I don't want to cut any of these off. So definitely still a bit of work to do at the anvil. I'm just out of time, folks. But you can start to see the way the pattern, let me see if I can get this up a little closer. You can see the way the pattern starts to form here. And as I grind into this, the pattern is going to get better and better. But just wanted to show you guys that. Definitely coming together as a Turkish twist. I think it'll look pretty cool. So thanks for joining me on this episode, folks. I will finish this up in a future episode, show you guys what we got. But for now, I'm going to end it here. Thanks, folks, and we will see you on the next one.